Penguin Random House Audio presents A Woman in Arabia, The Writings of the Queen of the Desert by Gertrude Bell, edited by Georgina Howell, read for you by Sian Thomas and Adjoa Andoh. Introduction. The phenomenal Gertrude Lothian Bell came from a family of wealthy British industrialists in the north of England in the mid-19th century. From sheep farmers and blacksmiths, they had become the sixth richest family in Britain. The Bells, at their most powerful, employed some 45,000 workers at their steel and chemical works and mines. They made the steel components, weighing 50,000 tons, for the Sydney Harbour Bridge and the track for hundreds of thousands of miles of railways all over the world. They were intellectuals, liberal voters, and anti-aristocracy, although they had begun to marry into the nobility. In childhood, Gertrude met the scientists, writers, and statesmen of the day as they visited her grandfather and her father in Yorkshire. Men such as Charles Dickens, Charles Darwin, Robert Louis Stevenson, and William Morris. Even as a child, Gertrude was intimidated by no one, telling a divinity teacher that she
didn't believe a word of it.
She began her adult life at 20, in 1888, by becoming the first woman to gain first-class honours in modern history at Oxford University. After a life full of adventure and rule-breaking and exploration, she did something of unique importance. She founded a nation, the nation of Iraq. Her father, Hugh Bell, was married at 23 to Mary Shield, a beautiful local girl. She was the daughter of a Newcastle merchant. Gertrude was their first child, born in 1868. Tragically, Mary Bell survived only 3 weeks after the birth of their second child, Gertrude's brother, Morris. Hugh became, for a time, a poignant figure, working 6 days a week at the Clarence Steelworks in Middlesbrough. His sister Ada moved in to run the house and look after the children. Hugh had to share his Sundays with his sister, a wet nurse, and some half-dozen servants. Through the matchmaking of his two sisters, he met and then married Florence Evelyn Eleanor Olive. She had been born and brought up in Paris, where her father was physician to the British Embassy. The good-hearted Florence, who now became mother to Gertrude, adored children and domestic life. She wrote plays and novels and became heavily involved in social work, into which she would co-opt Gertrude whenever she was at home for long enough. Florence wrote a groundbreaking factual book, At the Works, the result of 30 years of interviews with the families of steelworkers, exposing the suffering they endured. The bond between Hugh and the 8-year-old Gertrude was extraordinary. They were everything to each other, and would remain so even when living on opposite sides of the world. Florence was to write a novel concerning the second wife of a man whose bond with his daughter was so strong as almost to exclude his wife. The deep mutual affection was to both the very foundation of existence until the day she died. Florence never tried to divide them, but she had difficulty with Gertrude, who was used to bossing the household and running rings around her unfortunate governesses. She was domineering and willful. She would climb on the greenhouse roof. She played the garden hose down the laundry chimney and flooded the fire. And she galloped about the countryside and beaches on her ponies while her small brother tried to follow her, coming home covered with cuts and bruises. It was not long before Florence had her own children, Hugo, Elsa, and Molly. Gentle and forbearing as Florence was, she found the teenage Gertrude too much for her, scowling, noisy, argumentative, opinionated, bursting with energy, and thirsty for knowledge. And so, most unusually for a girl of her wealth and class, Gertrude was sent to school in London, to Queen's College in Harley Street, and from there to Lady Margaret Hall, Oxford. Having done that with brilliance, Gertrude came back to a Florence determined to get rid of her Oxfordy manner and turn her into a marriageable prospect. For a while, before becoming a debutante presented to the Queen at court, she was entrusted with housekeeping, care of her sisters and brothers, and bookkeeping. As a reward, she was given a wardrobe of wonderful clothes and sent on holiday to embassies in Bucharest, Tehran, and Berlin, where her uncle was British ambassador. She went around the world twice, once with her brother Maurice, and the second time with her half-brother Hugo. She must be one of the best documented women of all time. There are 75 feet of shelving in the Bell archive, with its 16,000 letters, 16 diaries, 7 archaeological field books, dozens of small leather notebooks, and the 3,000 items collected under the heading Miscellaneous. Then there are her 8 published books and hundreds of political position papers. There are also 7,000 glass plates of the photographs she took of archaeological sites, now ransacked or crumbled away, and images of Middle Eastern life as it had been lived for thousands of years. Those are the papers and photographs in Newcastle University alone. As a highly skilled photographer and a member of the Royal Photographic Society, she carried 2 cameras into the desert, one that took glass plates 6.5 inches high by 4.25 inches wide, the other designed for panoramic views. To scan an entire archaeological site, she would combine carefully angled shots to give exact panoramas, which are prized by Newcastle's School of Historical Studies for their depiction of monuments and churches before they were further eroded and damaged. Her first book in print was Persian Pictures, a collection of essays written about her stay in Tehran and her introduction to the desert. She thought this book to be too slight, but was persuaded to publish nonetheless. Poems from the Divan of Hafiz was a collection of work of the 14th century Sufi master who is Persia's most famous poet. Gertrude became fluent in the language to make the translations and then rendered them in lyrical English. The Desert and the Sown was the account of her 1905 trip across the Syrian desert from Jericho to Antioch. The 1001 Churches, written with scholar Sir William Mitchell Ramsay, was an investigation of the Hittite and Byzantine site of Bin Berkeleyza in Turkey in 1907. The book led to Gertrude's election as a fellow of the Royal Geographical Society. The private diaries she wrote for her lover Dick Doughty Wiley, containing the account of her incarceration in Ha'il, were edited by Rosemary O'Brien and published in 2000 under the title The Arabian Diaries, 1913-14. Amarat to Amarat came from her 1909 6-month journey through Syria and along the unexplored banks of the Euphrates. The palace and mosque at Ahazir and the vaulting system at Ahazir contained her meticulous drawings and measurements of the enormous ruined palace she discovered in the desert near Karbala. The churches and monasteries of the Tur Abdin took her back to Ahazir and north to Turkey in 1911. Gertrude's handbook, The Arab of Mesopotamia, written by request as an introduction to the region for the military officers and civil servants who were posted there after World War I, is a collection of essays. Some of these are rigorously informative, and some are eccentric and amusing. A book-length white paper for the British government, Review of the Civil Administration of Mesopotamia, explained the problems and solutions that confronted the High Commission when it arrived in Basra, and then in Baghdad, after the Turkish retreat. From the time she took up her post as Major Miss Bell in the Intelligence Bureau in Cairo in 1915, and no longer had time to keep a diary, she told her father that her letters to the family would in future be her diary, and asked him to keep them. Her work at the Bureau was secret, and there was much she omitted to tell, but she continued to write home 2 or 3 times a week. The letters were so regular, over so many years, that their rare cessation signalled an interval of a few days during which she was doing something secret. There are 3 missing days and nights in November 1915, which give the clue to a mystery that has perplexed historians for 100 years. See The Lover. The second time, during the period in which she was an intelligence officer in Basra, was April the 16th to 27th, 1916. Those were exactly the days in which her friends, T.E. Lawrence and Aubrey Herbert, with whom she had discussed
vast schemes for the government of the universe
the previous week, were entrusted with the attempt to break the Turkish siege of Kut, in which starving British soldiers and townspeople were reduced to eating rats and dogs. According to Gertrude's letters home, she went
up the Shat al-Arab to check the maps.
After her death, King Faisal referred to further unrecorded adventures in which she nearly lost her life, saying she could play a man's part in the action. She ventured alone and disguised into the remotest districts. Death held no fear for her. Her personal safety was her last consideration. In the same interview, he added the extraordinary assertion that she had, on one occasion, led some tribesmen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.